Good evening, everyone, and welcome to this year's annual summit of our advisory boards. We're going to get started here in a minute, our advisory boards and committees. This is a council meeting, official council meeting, so we are going to have to take care of a few little things first. And at this time, I would entertain a motion to the council members here that we adopt our agenda, which will be the only item on here will be how can we improve our caring community? Could I get a...
So moved.
Any discussion on that, folks? All in favor?
Aye.
All right, that looks like that's unanimous. So that's going to be the topic for the evening. And again, I want to thank you. I know this can be a logistical nightmare for some of you, having to shuffle your schedules around and everything to get here. But thank you for your loyalty and dedication to this city. Without you, a lot of things wouldn't get done. And you're playing a very important part in what we do here as elected leaders. We will be entering in our budget cycle here very shortly. A lot of the information that's gleaned from the exercises that we're going to do here tonight will be very important to us as far as setting priorities and determining our direction and which way we plan to go this year. All of you, I know that some of you have been volunteering, doing service for this city for a long time. And some of you just a short time. We got some short timers with us tonight, our youth council folks. Would you all rise, please, so everybody can see you? We decided that this year we would want to include them in our discussions. We feel that their perspective is very necessary. These folks are going to be the adults that are running this city here in the next few years, hopefully. And, you know, why not start reaping the benefits of their knowledge and experiences up to this point right now? Again, we know that the city's motto is a caring community. We're going to expand on that in just a second. But again, I want to welcome all of you. And hopefully this will be an enriching experience for us and an enriching experience for you. And at this time, I'd like to ask, I believe Glenn's going to come up and talk to you a little bit about the Caring Community Program.
Good evening. I'm so happy that I have some people who've lived through this with me so we can won't be the only one that's holder of some of these activities and things to this effect. I was asked this evening just to kind of give a little bit of background on the caring community and how it came to be on the city seal and such of that. It was during the fall and winter of 1990 when it was apparent that there was a massive scale of deployment that was to occur here in Jacksonville. It was occur as a result of Operation Desert Storm and then subsequent Desert Shield, as it was. The largest number of Marines in formation at one time were set in just a few weeks to assemble at WPT Hill Field. And in that run-up, what was happening was there were so many people that were abandoning their leases on apartments. There were deploying persons, the family members of deploying persons were being sent home because they feared this was going to be a long and drawn out war. And there were a group of military wives, and on a hot summer Friday morning, they met with Mayor George Jones. They said they were fearful about so many people leaving the community and losing that connection to what the community meant to them so they could find out about their loved ones who were deploying and find out what was going to happen next. And they were asking the mayor to help take action to calm their fears, to rally support for spouses to stay in the area, and to make the community aware of their plight. Well, there had been a group that had been working on some civic education and awareness projects. And they were asked to help work on the All America City application. And it was a diverse group that included people from the Human Services Council, from Onslow Christmas Cheer. They were with the faith community, Coastal Carolina Community College, the school system, the city, and the county. And Mayor Jones came to the newsroom where I was at and asked if I'd help lead an effort to find support for these spouses. And on that Monday morning, in this hastily called meeting, it was a standing room only crowd. it was remarkable to see the people who wanted to come out there and be this. And they agreed to call this the Caring Community Committee. We quickly learned that the fear of the spouses was matched by the fear of the merchants, who were scared they were going to have to close down, lay people off, do things because of what was going to be happening here. The bonding of those merchants and a caring community help the spouses left behind was immediate. The chamber helped by being the matchmaker of need to resources, and the Caring Merchants Network provided listings of those who wanted to help. Additionally, the college rallied to provide commercial continuity and to provide marketing expertise for those merchants about how to market during this time of deployments. And a key component was communication. Mayor Jones and other elected leaders made it themselves available for news conferences, for media briefings, for talks to groups about how spouses in the areas would have a much better connection with information about the deployments and their loved ones if they stayed here. In addition, the support network grew and blossomed. People outside the community wanted to help. They gave money for a program that was designed and administered through the USO to help persons who were struck with strange and unusual things that would happen because of the circumstance of deployments. Homes were opened up by the community to help offset travel costs for family members who came to visit those deploying and those left behind. A good neighbor network was created within certain neighborhoods to help watch after the families of those deployed. Churches and other groups developed a respite care program for mothers who needed some time away just to be there and while they were having to take care of their children. The school system developed a Dad's Away program to help children cope with parental separation. And the Thanksgiving Project, it was remarkable. It matched those empty seats at people's homes with people who had no other place to go. Eventually, so much happened that it came to be documented in a booklet, a brochure here, that later came to be the most requested resource the city had about how they had handled this Gulf War. After a significant shock and awe bombing campaign, the Iraqi ground war lasted but 4 days in February of 1991. Kuwait was declared liberated 100 hours after it began. The long deployment did not manifest in the manner that we all had feared, though it was still months on end when some streets in this community were pretty quiet. Thankfully, though, there was a new moniker in the community, and it made it for Jacksonville be known as a caring community. It was all as a result of that actions that had taken place on that Friday morning where this community spontaneously responded to a need that it knew it had. The same enthusiasm that helped to prepare for the deployment came forward to welcome them back. This place was festooned with yellow ribbons. There were everywhere, and a massive parade was held down Western Boulevard with Governor Martin receiving them at the end of the parade, personally welcomed them back. Late in 1991, on a memo written by Councilmember Jerry Bittner, the seal was amended to include a yellow ribbon and the words, a caring community. In 1992, the city was designated an All-America City. The Caring Community Committee, formed from the All-America City Committee, lives on. The Jacksonville Civic Affairs Committee was created, and in 1999, it dissolved to allow the creation of the Onslow Civic Affairs Committee, of which there are several members here this evening joining us. The spirit of a caring community lives on beyond the seal. It is the name of the free clinic operated by the Onslow Community Outreach, the Caring Community Clinic. It's the name of an effort to help create endowments for nonprofits and charitable causes. The Caring Communities Foundation has more than $3 million it administers here in Onslow County. The spirit embraced with the caring community was also cited when the city council said it was their moral responsibility to help clean up Wilson Bay after the closure of the wastewater treatment plant there. The council was proud that there were no mandates from the state nor federal government to do so. They just wanted to do it. It lives on with what is a new program now called NC Serves. They met in these very room that we're into this evening, and it helps to match active duty, retired, and veterans and their families with services that are in the community and that are not in the community. In 1996, there was a program right after this that matched needs of persons who were homeless and hungry and needed help from the charitable community. And it was created through the Caring Community Network, operated by NC SPIN out of UNCW in Wilmington, to help churches that had a small resource that they wanted to amplify be able to match to the right people. It's regularly used to describe the outstanding spirit of volunteerism and clarity and charity that exist in our community. It's exemplified in this observances that we do every year, where our community shows the concern for those who gave the ultimate sacrifice. And it played into the decision by the Jacksonville Tourism Development Authority to use "Receive a Hero's Welcome" as their marketing tagline. It was intentionally created to follow on a caring community to connect our military heritage with how we wanted to welcome guests that come to our community. In a community where half the school students are attending a different school every year, it's important to display this spirit regularly and to display how it makes our community of military and civilian to be the type of community that welcomes those while they call this place home. It is this time of discourse and many over many things that the caring community is most challenged to continually demonstrate this spirit. However, we can all be proud of the efforts that are easy to spot, where concern for others is demonstrated regularly. I personally see it every year in Christmas cheer. I see it in local congregations about how they have a military ministry and do things like that. We see it in the new NC Serves project. And we see it in the mayor's call for discussion with the faith community. I see it in the dialogue between groups of very disparate interest. And I see it in the way that this community steps up and responds to true and unique needs. And I see it in your service to this community as volunteers for the city of Jacksonville. And it is that that the mayor that will call now on our illustrious city manager, Dr. Richard Woodruff, to talk about how this evening you're going to advance this work that will describe us as a caring community on into the future. Thank you.
Certainly appreciate Glenn giving us the overview of that. In order to look forward, it's important in life to also look back. You need to know where you've been in order many times to know where you're going to be going. And tonight you have heard the history, and tonight we're asking you to help make the future. As a caring community, we have to be careful that that tagline doesn't just simply become words on a sheet of paper or words on a seal. It's nothing different than what you do in your life every day. You can talk about cleaning your house. You can talk about getting New Year's resolutions. But it's all only talk. What we have to have is action. The house doesn't clean itself. My wife reminds me of that regularly. And likewise, we don't move this community forward simply by talking about it. So tonight, this is the third or fourth time we've gotten together in this setting. In the past, you identified some 76 items that you would like for us to work on. And last year, you heard a report on how we were doing with some of those. And yes, I've already had a water and sewer advisory person say, well, number one was the swimming pool. Where is it? Well, it's actually relatively shallow. It's called a splash pad. But at least the city council got started on the first of our water features. And maybe one day the community will have a swimming pool. But we do listen. The mayor and council do listen and value your advice. Tonight, we need to focus, though, on moving us forward as a caring community. What actions do we need to take that will make us continue to be a caring community and improve that? We're very fortunate this evening to have such a great turnout. As I call the advisory group, I'd like for you to stand. We purposely mixed you up. You know, government's good about mixing up people. I know that's what you were thinking. But we ask you to be in what we call a mixed group, because when water and sewer gets together, y'all are used to talking about water and sewer. Maybe you'd like to hear about parks and recreation or environmental and appearance or civic affairs. So let's begin, and we will start with the civic affairs group, and we're pleased this evening to have one of the new county commissioners with us. Mr. Bennett, good to see you tonight. And if the people on the Civic Affairs Committee will stand and be recognized, please.
Great.
Thank you. Okay, we mentioned water and sewer. So, flowing along with the program, no pun intended there, Jim. Water and sewer, please stand. Parks and Recreation, please stand. Youth Council, please stand. Planning Advisory Board, please stand. Environmental and Appearance, please stand. Now, if you're part of an advisory board, and at my age, I forgot what board there is, please stand and be recognized and tell me what I left out. Community. Anybody get left out?
Community development.
Community development. One of my favorite ones. Okay, community development, please stand. Thank you, Marcia. Okay, you will notice that we have a couple of tables that are not really full. So what we will probably ask is tables 1 and 2 to combine. I think some of these groups up here, you may want to decide if some of you want to join 6 and some of you want to join 8. Let's talk about how the program will work tonight. It'll work very well, okay? The first thing we need for you to do is if you have one of these with you, turn it off. We really want you to be able to focus tonight and not to worry about somebody calling you to tell you that, you know, your water is running because we need the revenue. And we really don't have to go anywhere tonight because New Year's is already over, so you can stay open. All the football games are over with, so you can stay with us till 11 or 12 o'clock, okay? Good. Please turn these off. Restrooms, if you haven't been in the building before or if you have and you have forgotten, they're back here to my right. And feel free, just in the middle of the evening, just feel free to go back there. As far as the activity, we're dividing the evening into 3 parts. The first activity is to look back at what you believe have been the most successful components of making us a caring community. We're going to ask at each table, we've identified scribes. So staff members who are scribes, please raise your hand. Okay. You thought they were all part of the youth council, didn't you? That's it. Patrick, you can pay me later for that. Okay. But the scribes will be recording the things that you believe are the top things that have made us a caring community. We're then going to ask you to come up. We'll give you 15 minutes to identify those. We will then ask you to come forward here to make the table presentations. Why? Well, because we're recording it, and we don't have amplification equipment throughout the auditorium. So we need for you to come here one table at a time. Between session 1 and session 2, we will take a short break for you to actually go through the dinner line. Dinner, in this case, is in a box, and let me tell you why. Because we like box lunches at City Hall. But the other reason is we want you to get that box lunch and come right back to your table and get to work on assignment number 2. Assignment number 2 is going to be looking forward, what are activities that your table believes we should engage in that will make us a better caring community in the next 5 years? So that's going to be a working supper. We don't want you to drift off and socialize with other people. Get back to your tables as quickly as possible and begin to work on session 2. Session 3 is going to be where we're going to ask each of the advisory groups to get together as advisory groups. We have purposely mixed you for 1 and 2. Session 3, though, is going to be you as an advisory group looking at the recommendations for the future and determining what your advisory committee or board can specifically do to help implement 1 or 2 or 3 of the items. So those are pretty much the instructions. We are expecting a lot of noise and a lot of participation. So at this point, I'm going to read to you again the assignment for number 1. Assignment 1, identify current actions in our community that are demonstrating Jacksonville is a caring community. I'll ask the City Council to mingle And if you would, please begin now. You have 15 minutes. Okay, over the last 15 minutes or so, we've had a lot of energy in the room talking about the items of the past which have made us a caring community. It's now time for reporting. As we mentioned earlier, we'd like for one person from each table to come up. If the scribes will assist by bringing the various things that you have identified, and then let the person from your table report. Knowing that we will begin in alphabetical order, such as 1, 2, 3, 4, you do understand that that's Clemson alphabet, right? Okay. Let's start with the group at the top, group number 8. Why don't y'all come and report first?
He's still scribing. He's got to be scribing.
Now, we don't expect you to actually see the handwriting. But if you would, at this time, Sarah, you're going to report for Group 8.
Okay. Thank you. So we talked about all these great lists that we have here. The first is that it's a small town feel, that Jacksonville is still a big city, but it still has the feel of a small town. There's lots of free and inexpensive community activities, and I'll just share just a really quick story. When we were at Winterfest this year, I had all my kids out there, and I was standing next to a man I had just met, and he said, you know, my wife and I, we've decided to retire here. We have young kids, and this is the place we want to raise them because we have things like this here. And I thought, wow, that says a lot about Jacksonville because we're willing to put forth that kind of investment in the people that live here. The next is clean and green programs, increasing cultural opportunities like the symphony and the ballet companies that have come to town, trails and greenway, the bike trail that goes around town is fantastic, collaboration with military communities from nonprofits in town and churches, Jacksonville transit system, and that Jacksonville is a diverse community. There's an amount of volunteerism for the community, and that there's a great cooperation with the city leadership between the community and the officials. So,
well done. Thank you. Well done. Now, just to show you how committed Sarah and her husband are to this community, every year they have a new child. Almost true. They have two handsome young men and two beautiful little girls. How old is your youngest?
She'll be a year.
Okay, so it's almost time for it. Okay. Anyway. Let's go to the other end of the spectrum. We combined one and two. So the combined group of one and two, someone come up, please. Okay, Suzanne Nelson will be presenting for group 1-2.
Thank you very much. All right, so we had several ideas and then we tried to group them together. So the first one was under Rec and Parks, and that was dealing with the programs as well as the facilities, and also including for the youth as well as adults and senior citizens. Our second one was community beautification. That was dealing with the landscaping along the corridors, the cleanliness of the parks, and also the downtown housing redevelopment. And the last one was community outreach, which was mainly focused on Christmas cheer as well as parades and the different ceremonies that are throughout the year to honor, especially the military. So that was ours.
Thank you very much.
Terrible.
Anthony went to Appalachian State, in case you were wondering, and that's that's Appalachian State Greek language, I suppose. Okay, which table are you? Five. Okay, we'll jump to the middle. Group five. Have a youth council member going to make a presentation. Introduce yourself, please.
Hello, my name is Tatiana Manguel, and I'm on the Jacksonville Youth Council. So with this, we discussed about volunteerism, especially with the soup kitchen and Christmas cheer. We also got into memorial observances as well as the Beirut Memorial, the 9/11 observance. Also with Jacksonville Youth Council, I thought it was important to me because it shows that the community does care about how our youth feels and our youth voices. We also got into the Holiday Cemetery with the wreaths. There is a community group out here that puts the wreaths on the graveyards. Also, the medical clinic. We do have free clinic here, and as well, again, our Christmas cheer.
Thank you, Tashi Evan. Very good. Okay, we'll jump back to table number six.
Workman's comp
claim.
Good afternoon. Good evening, everybody. Big part of this was, some have already mentioned, ditto, but parks and ways, our greenways, our parks and recreation groups, that the outstanding service that they do, and our landscaping, beautification of the city, roadways and improvements. We had some volunteer opportunities, so the soup kitchen was mentioned. The military parade, going back to the memorials that Jacksonville also steps into, the communication with the base, the partnership, the police present, community policing, and then again, Sturgeon City, Wilson Bay, the cleanup, and also the Jacksonville Landing. And real quick, how many people in this room, I know there's a few of you, been born and raised here? Raise your hand. Same thing here. So it's takes a big part of our community to come back, because I won't tell my age, but I can remember when Court Street was Court Street and you stayed away and all that good stuff. And I think I can stand up here and the mayor and all these guys here, and it's really changed over the years. Way to go, Chief.
Lori graduated from high school here in 2015, in case you were wondering. So, good. Okay, let's see, table number four. Representing the Chamber of Commerce tonight will be Lorette Ligon.
That's not supposed to be your first
one.
It's a lot of
fluff. Thank you. We took the approach, like several others, we just did a big picture and talked
among ourselves about the individual things, but everything that goes on in the Memorial Gardens. Now we're getting all the other things finished with the Montfort Point, things are moving with the Vietnam, and of course the Beirut Memorial Remembrance each year. So all of those things that go on there. A big nod to the various groups that put on events in downtown. They feel the way that brings the community get together. And somebody said, families don't have a lot of money, so having these free events does make a difference. Access to the public schools and libraries. That was important to someone in our group. Service to the less fortunate. The faith collaborations. Our public safety involvement with the community. And one I like is the military transit. Imagine being on that base and not having to a ride to get anywhere. So I think that's valuable. Oh, and they gave a nod to the Chamber of Commerce.
Great job, Lorette. I think you are aware that every year in the Thanksgiving holiday, the mayor and council authorize a free ridership program. So from Thursday of Thanksgiving through Sunday evening of the Thanksgiving weekend, our transit system is free. This past year, we had over 1,500 riders in that four-day period, and over a third of them were military personnel. As Lorette has also mentioned, for $3, I may already have $2, I only have a dollar in my pocket, so. But for $3, you can get a pass from riding to the base to the mall. That is something that the city council feels important, like Lorette said. It gives the folks at the base who do not have transportation or have the need for something other than a taxi service, it gives them a very affordable way to be involved in our community. Nice job. Okay, let's see. Table 7. Now, in case you don't know, 7 is the lucky number for the New York Yankees because that was the number for Mickey Mantle. But if you're not a Yankees fan like Boston Red Sox, you don't have any history. So just remember, number 7 stands for the New York Yankees. Carol Hurst Long, please.
Thank you. You talked about Jacksonville Transit. I have to plug in Onslow United Transit System because we do it together. We are the same as the other people. We put a series of things down, and most of ours are the same ones that the other people had talked about. The Memorial Gardens and their ceremonies and their observances. The community entrance enhancement. And I just think that it shows you how much Jacksonville cares when you look at the new plannings that have been going on, the cleanup around the intersections. It invites someone to come in. I think it's all curb appeal. It's almost like selling your house. If you don't have it pretty, then no one's going to stop in. So I think that's been a great enhancement to Jacksonville. We have a strong nonprofit sector in Jacksonville. And I think a lot of us that serve on these advisory boards are part of the nonprofit sector. NC Serves, which was a grant that was given, it was a national grant, this one helps with the veterans. It's very large with the veterans. We did the 75th anniversary for the 2nd Marine Division last February on that cold, cold morning. The splash pad, we talked about this last year or year before last, I can't remember, but it's there. It came to fruition. And that shows you that the city is listening to what the needs are or the wants, not just you have to have it, but the wants that the citizens of Jacksonville would like. The schools, we feel like the access to the schools and the library are very important. And also the partnerships that we have with the base, with Onslow County, with the city of Jacksonville, with the school system, all that works into a community, caring community for Jacksonville. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Carol. At Christmas cheer this year, the OUTS program, which Carol leads, provided free transportation for any person who needed to come from their home, regardless of where they were in the county. We had people, one person I know came from almost Maysville, up that way, almost Jones County. OUTS provided that free. That's a caring service. Table 3, I believe you're the last one, if you would please. Now, the man behind the sunglasses is sometimes known as Wheels. Jim, come up and give us your report. Young man with him is the incoming president of the Youth Council. Watch your step on the...
Here we go. Okay. We weren't as organized as some of the other groups. We didn't organize. We pretty much brainstormed for our allotted time. But I think we could probably group our ideas into three categories: appearance, opportunity, and communications, how the city communicates to the citizens. So just going through this, what I put down was the Clean and Green program, which has already been mentioned. If you come into a city as a visitor and you see a bunch of trash, what's your first impression? Okay, splash pad, elimination of some blight, landscaping, which has already been mentioned, the city partnership with nonprofits, the amphitheater, the bike paths, the bike trails, the mowing that the Parks Department does. Jacksonville Landing has been a big success. If you ever look at the boat trailers and vehicles parked over in Jacksonville Landing, you got to ask yourselves, how did they squeeze in that little parking lot by the USO? Well, they didn't. I think we're giving more opportunity to people like to go out on the water with the landing. Affordable housing, the city website, G10, and the City Connect are the way we communicate with our citizens and get word out. The police and city partnership, the Are You OK program that the police has for our seniors that live by themselves, Citizens Academy, the committees and the boards, which we're all members of in here, the Christmas Cheer, the Soup Kitchen, and the Homeless Shelter have all been mentioned before. But again, I think you could probably go through and group these brainstorm ideas into three categories: the appearance, opportunity for our citizens and visitors, and then the third thing is how we communicate to our citizens what's going on. That's pretty much a wrap.
Good job. Thank you. You know, Jim is a person who puts his feet where his mouth is. And let me explain that. Part of what he does is to go out among the waterways of Jacksonville and actually pick up litter. Jim, in the past year, how many bags, how many tons?
In the past year?
Yes.
I just gave my report to Pat Donovan Potts, and that was 4 days ago, and I can't remember where I parked my car 2 hours ago. Dr. Woodruff, I think I'm about 6,100 bags of trash right now in 6 years, and this past year is about 1,200 bags.
Excellent. If you didn't hear that, 6,100 bags of material collected from our waterway systems. This isn't out on the streets. This is actually the waterway system. And if you're a fisher person or a water person, you know how important it is to have those areas clean. So, Jim, thank you for what you do. Now, you've completed task one, which is looking back. We're now going to begin task two. But before you do, I'd like to remind you what we'd like for you to do is go out through. Mr. Willingham, would you stand, please? Mr. Willingham will give you directions back to your right, his left, and go through. There are box lunches. You'll notice that it will say on the box lunch the type of meat, whether it's ham or whether it's turkey. I believe one or two people have asked for a special supper. Sorry about the filet mignon. It didn't arrive. But as you go through, we would ask for you to grab your box supper, grab something to drink, and come back to your table. And when you do, please begin with task two. Now, let me remind you what task two is. Task two. Each table is now asked to have someone, whoops, that's not task two. Let me go back to task two. Task two. Identify new actions that can improve Jacksonville as a caring community. Now, this is going to be harder. It's always easy to look back over your shoulder and see what you've done. The important thing now is use your imagination, think outside the box, identify things that we can do that we're currently not doing. So at this point, let's break to grab the box lunches, come back and start assignment two. I want to thank everybody for the exciting items that you've identified moving around the tables. I see a lot of good ideas. We're going to do it in reverse order this time. So I believe that table three was the last to report. So Lily, if whoever's going to give you a report this time from table three. Now this has to do with those items that we should consider for the future that will move us forward and become an even better caring community. Steve Forney of Steve Forney Travel Adventures across the United States. Since he retired from Coastal Community College, he now leads adventure trips throughout the United States with his wife, Deb. So,
you know, we have to take a look at the things we drove by for so many years.
I probably didn't even need this. All right. What we have in this particular case, and we made sure to make it the number one item, comes back to that public-private indoor pool. Olympic size, things that can be used both as recreation and could in fact support the high schools and all that in swimming competition. And if you do competitions, you can bring people in economically and put heads on beds. What we have here, too, is a lot of times we get into our own little item, and sometimes it's good to go to other cities and take a look at what they've got. So we put it up there. And how did they do it? That's also something. We also talked about improving code enforcement, and we're talking about trash, ugliness, all those types of things. And to incorporate pretty much all the different areas of the city into reporting it back to a central place, and then somebody going and attempting to fix it. Yes, I was the one that said, do this. I see no reason we can't have a events civic center similar to Duplin County, right here in this area. That can be a county, city, everybody getting together to do it. And again, that brings more heads on beds. Increase economic development beyond retail. We've got to make our city, its infrastructure, its appearance, and everything look great. Because those people who want to invest in economic development, something that manufactures, makes things, ships them out, they want to come to a nice place. Everybody agree on that? These, thanks to Oliver at our table, there's a whole group of them that talks about increase diversity and inclusiveness in minority male summit. I believe there's a city, was it Raleigh, you said, Lily, that has the Human Relations Commission? And that's a commission that kind of hears problems. And you might even have one set of problems, male minorities. You may have one that gets together for single family members and how to fix things. More sidewalks, and of course with more sidewalks, we also want more crosswalks. Transitional housing for homeless victims and domestic violence. And more involvement with ex-offender reentry programs. There's a whole bunch of us that don't have problems, but there's some that have problems and they need help.
Well done.
Where are we going?
Great list of opportunities. Let's see. I believe table 7. Are y'all ready? Ryan, y'all ready? Table 7? Well, reverse to me is, 3 and 7 make 10. That's how I got to you being next.
Call me off guard.
And introduce yourself, please.
Hi, all. I'm Taylor Rutter, member of the Jacksonville Youth Council. So we came up with several different ideas for what we want to see in the future Jacksonville. The first one we came up with, and one of the biggest, was a teen community center. when I attended the youth summit for the Jacksonville Youth Council, almost all of the groups came up with ideas that we wanted more places for teens to be able to stay, to lower crime, not just because crime rates for younger ages are increasing, and that's not a good thing. We don't have enough places to be able to stay to get teens out of trouble. So we came up with creating a teen community center for that. Also, not enough people, especially teens in school, have access to the proper technology and internet sources that they need. So we were thinking of creating some type of either allowing the schools to be open, so they can use their media centers, or some type of media center place that's mainly just for teens who need that access. We also came up with the idea of more youth employment. A long time ago here, they had youth employment, which is, it's an 8-week thing over the summer. And for those families that don't have enough money or who need the extra support, that's a great way for that to happen. And it's also really good for the for students to be able to get real life experiences. Let's see. We also wanted more intergenerational cooperation. So for those young families who are all by themselves, who either their spouse is deployed, since we're a big military family, or they just don't have the family that they need to help them. Like for those with young children, instead of having to go to the hospital for the simple of things, we have those who are older and more experienced with that to be able to help them. When we have new companies come here, we want to be able to see that those who need the jobs, who live in here already, can get them before people move from other places to come with the company. And we also want more opportunities for the retired. And we're such a big military town that it's really sad to see that a lot of our homeless people are actually vets. We want to be able to help them because they've served us for such a long time. It's almost their right for us to be able to help them back with whatever they need. So these are some of the ideas we came up with for the future of Jacksonville.
Well done. Good job. Excellent job. Excellent job. Okay, how about table 4? Who's going to present this time? By unanimous election. Introduce yourself.
Thanks, sir. Again, I'm Bernard Lane from Parks and Recreations. Our group, 4, we came up with needing more bus stop shelters due to the fact of inclement weather. There are some bus stops where people are just standing around and getting rained on and stuff like that. We need to have the shelters need to be done. Downtown flooding issues, we all know that's the issue. We want to make sure we bring it up, keep bringing it up, and keep bringing it up. The traffic concerning, that's Court Street and New Bridge Street. As you're coming through Court Street, where is there new coffee, Biagio's, yes. That area, when you come down the area, you have to go into the street before you see incoming cars. So it needs to be some type of some type of mirror up there, see where you can see the blind spots. Matching facade grants. Facade grants, please. Matching facade grants. We know what that is. Expand the senior citizen services. Want to make sure that we know the senior services over in Commons area, yes. We try to make sure to have more in the city areas for the citizens because for purpose of just spreading it out. We also came up with a multi-purpose center. As the center can be used for several things, such as the Chamber of Commerce parties that they have all the time. The Marine Corps balls, you know, graduations, high school graduations, high school proms and stuff like that. A center also can be used for different multi-purposes, as she was just explaining. It could be a communication area where teens can go and stuff like that. Just a multi-purpose, something bigger for the youth to have and for just a whole multi-purpose center. Expand soup kitchen. A little bit further out, we need to reach out with that a little more. We also talk about the Women's Center and theater and arts. Try to, of course, we know the theater's coming up, and that's one of the things we want to make sure we push because the city is growing, and so we want to make sure that we grow while the city is growing. It's making sure there's a lot of things we can do. Thank you.
Oh, wrong thing.
You did a nice job. Yeah, Loretta, I can see it now. Join the chamber and party, party, party. Yeah, Loretta will tell you, you've got to find your customers where they want to be. Right, Loretta? Okay. But very good ideas. Let's jump back. Let's see. Table 5. And backed by a popular demand, an excellent job.
So we came up with better jobs, also for youth as well. Sport facilities, the YMCA, and maybe improve on the Boys and Girls Club. Also better communication, volunteering, nonprofit needs. We were also thinking of like a multi-purpose room with our large venue for have entertainment and sports and events, stuff like that. Also better housing, and we were thinking of temporary housing when you're moving from one house and you're trying to transition to a new one, but you haven't quite found that perfect house yet. Also expand clean and green for neighborhoods and community resources.
What did you mean by community resources? Can you expound on that?
For community resources, we were thinking more of, put it into terms, like that.
Okay, better community. That was very well said. Okay. No. You know, that is something we all face, and that is we have a need, we don't know how to fill it, that we don't know who to call. For the military, there's a new program that Ron Massey's been working, and some of you have been working on this year, and that is to bring to the Jacksonville area a new program that will help veterans identify through one source their needs. So instead of going to this agency and finding it's not them and trying to go to another agency, find the central point. Okay, let's go to table 2, please.
Good evening. My name is Benita. I'm with the Parks and Rec, and I'm at table 2, and our group came up with these following actions. We felt that there should be a bigger meeting space or some type of conference or convention center. It was raised that sororities and fraternities want to come here, but they can't because they're not places that can house like 500 or so people. And so therefore the county is losing money because these people can stay in hotels and they can frequent the restaurants and shop. Also a need for an athletic complex or a tournament type thing where people can go and play sports. Partnerships for joint usage of facilities with the county and the military.
high school age programs and activities that don't just include sports, but other things that teenagers would be interested in that are not interested in sports. And monthly awareness forums for the public, like a monthly meeting where the topics kind of rotate on different things such as mental wellness, hypertension, diabetes, affordable housing, domestic violence, to get the information out on the end of prevention, which will also save the community money instead of always trying to follow up at the end to fix what's wrong. And yard cleanup, I think it was like trash cans to put in yard waste, more of those. That's it.
Nice job. Thank you. You know, when it comes to the containers for yard waste, about 2 years ago, the young lady who works in our sanitation department, Terry, came up with the idea of taking our residential garbage cans, which had been used by others and were literally sitting on the side of a shelter over at Public Works waiting to be recycled, that we should clean them up and put a new lid on them that is yellow so that people could put horticultural waste in. Over 300 containers are now out in the community for that purpose. So over the next several years, as more and more containers come offline serving the residents for garbage, they will be cleaned, a new yellow lid put online, and many of you have that yellow lid. If you have one of the yellow lid containers here, would you raise your hand? Okay, we see 20, 30, 40, almost 50 of you have those containers. That's good. So, okay. Now, table six. Lori is back, and she's going to have an assistant this time.
You'll notice our theme is based on youth. A couple things here, and I added as we were all talking here, but drug use, preventive programs in high schools, partnering with the law enforcement, jobs, trade, working better with the community college here so we can start getting folks adapt to more trade-type industries, civic center, which I think has been one or two or three or four times already mentioned. On the side here, I wrote safety stations throughout the city. I know a lot of colleges, universities have them. But little safe stations where somebody walking through our community or our city can, if they feel something's going wrong, a button they can push or a station they can go to and call 911. Better Amtrak hub, an increase of the Jacksonville youth visibility in schools. More open trails safety along lines with that. Amusement park, affordable, either joint with private or public. More events for youth again, volunteer opportunities at the schools, more teen safe spaces, more teen centers, YMCAs come to mind, and elimination stricter on the slum and the blight areas that we have throughout the city.
You know, when it comes to eliminating slum and blight, the mayor and council placed a priority on that. Lily Gray, would you stand up a minute? Lily has led an effort, along with the Community Development Advisory Committee, to eliminate slum and blight in this community. As of this past November, we tore down our 94th residential unit in 6 years. Our goal this year is to reach the 100 mark, and Lily has already identified 8 potential structures. So we will get there in 2010, whatever year we're coming into, we will get to the 100 mark. And Lily, I want to applaud you and CD for doing that. Table 8, who's going to present?
Good evening. I'm Will Artis. I'm with Marine Corps Community Services, and it's a pleasure to be here amongst all of you on this evening. A lot of what we have up here is redundant, as we've all discussed, but going through each item, entertainment for young adults, we've talked about that. a sports complex, not necessarily for someone just to play sports or activities, but to encourage activities to come here where we can go, like big games and things of that nature. I would put under here probably a subtopic, industry, you know, to create more economic growth in our county and our community, some additional industries. I mean, MCCS or the government, the base, is probably the largest provider of jobs in this county, followed probably by the school system. And we need something here to help us boost our economic status. Non-chain restaurants. These here are all linked together. More activities, riverfront, waterfront development activities, and more cultural arts activities. Speaking of the arts, I'm gonna be a little selfish here for a minute as the treasurer of the Jacksonville Arts Council. More activities, more push towards exposing the arts in our community is probably one of the most major things, in my opinion, that we need. Everybody's not a sports person. Everybody's not someone who enjoys politics. Some people just like to do art in whatever form, whether it's drawing, music, whatever. So we need to push in our community more activities. We had wonderful people on base who expressed their pain through service on art. And we need to probably promote that a little more. And I promise Cindy I wouldn't get on my soapbox about it, but I'm just so passionate about that. Farmers Market at Riverwalk, we're trying to grow that. We have wonderful people at our table who are into Farmers Market, as some of you probably are. So to grow that activity, to bring it will probably bring some more unity to our community, make us more attractive as a whole. And better attention for victim services, and this is something that I requested to add it in, because we have a wonderful Women's Center, and our base does victim advocacy work, but this is a fast-growing issue here. We just did our first holiday here as Freedom Day, and one of the things we talked about was human trafficking, and that's a fast-growing crime, one or two probably behind identity theft in this country. So we really need to pay attention and probably try to promote more services where we can help victims of not just domestic violence, which is growing, but all victim services. Because everyone who is a victim of a crime, everybody who suffers from a crime is a victim. So we need to pay more attention to that. In my opinion, it makes us more attractive as a community. So that's where we are.
Well done, Doctor. Had a lot of great ideas. It's almost 7 o'clock, and we promised several of you that we would be out of here by 11 o'clock. So you have 4 more hours for task number 3. But seriously, in fairness to you, what we'd like to do, since we are running a little long, is we'd like to have you at your next advisory committee meeting to think about everything you've heard tonight about the future and about the past. Think about something that your advisory committee can do. For example, I was talking to a person with Water and Sewer Advisory not too long ago, and they mentioned the fact that the deposit is a fairly steep deposit. And while you can get that deposit for your water account reduced by having a good credit score, maybe there are other things we could do. I don't know. If you're a caring community, we have all the young people who are moving here. Maybe that's an idea. Think out of the box. Parks and Recreation. Maybe some of the things that we're doing, such as before school and after school programs, are great, but maybe we need some other things in Parks and Recreation that can help. Housing, homeless, the needy. We are blessed as a city. There's no question about it. You can go around this community and you can see caring people, whether it was at Christmas cheer or whether it's here tonight and the ideas that you've given. At this time, I'd like to ask the mayor to come forward and conclude the meeting. But remember, at your next meeting, we're asking each of the advisory committees to focus and bring back to us your recommendations. Minutes will be prepared of all these ideas. So scribes, make sure that the individual cards where people wrote down their ideas, that you collect those. We will compile those into one document and get those out through your liaisons. Mayor Phillips.
Thank you, Richard. I would say I had the opportunity to go around to several tables tonight and heard a lot of really good ideas. I think this has been a very good exercise tonight. We've come away, we're going to walk away with some very valuable information to help us to to look into ourselves as a caring community. We want to keep working hard to make Jacksonville a better place, and that's our goal. That's the city council's goal. That's, I'm sure, the goal of everybody that serves on any of these advisory committees. You know, you're Jacksonville citizens, you're Jacksonville residents, and I know that your goal is to make Jacksonville a better place and a more caring community. Personally, I intend to make it a year-long effort to talk about improving our community as far as being a caring community. As Richard mentioned earlier, we have had some meetings with some of our local clergy ministers, and we're working on coming up with ideas from them, getting their input, and hopefully this is going to set us in a great direction for our community. One of the things we want to do is we want to look at the way we treat each other. We want to look at how to develop mutual respect, how we arrive at this. You know, the thing about it is we all just got to get along. You know, everybody's got to get along. We got to find a way that we're going to have to find that common ground. And I think through everybody working hard to come up with this, with our caring community and improving on that, I think that's going to set us in that right direction. I want to thank you so much for the service that you give to this city. I know a lot of you, you know, work a lot harder than I do, and it takes a lot of time out of your schedule to do it, but I have to commend you for all that you do. It takes a lot of sacrifice, self-sacrifice, I know, with your time, just being here tonight. This 2 hours right here, you could have been doing, I'm sure there's a lot of other things you could have been doing, but I thank you very much. It's been a very valuable session tonight. We will have our appreciation. We'll show our appreciation for your service to the city with our annual advisory board and committee appreciation dinner. And when is that going to be? That's going to be on Tuesday, April 25th at 6 p.m. And we have not come up with our location yet, but that's something we're going to work on, and we'll get out to you. Hope to see all of you there. But again, like I say, it's been a real joy listening to the enthusiasm and the comments and everything that have been made tonight. I want to thank all of the members of the Youth Council that are here tonight. This is the maiden voyage for y'all to be involved. And I had the opportunity to sit and listen to a couple of these young ladies over here. What table number are y'all? Tatiana? Number five. Hey, they were involved, I'm telling you. So, and I know the rest of you were too. I didn't get a chance to come around to some of your tables, but thank you very much for your input. We really, again, like I said at the first, we value your input into this process, because you're the future of our community, okay? And you should have a hand in developing that future. So with that,
well, before you go to that, we have one other recognition that we'd like to make. Tatiana, come up a second.
Tatiana.
Come stand around here. Now, Tatiana, where are you going to go to college?
Oh, the University of Baltimore.
And how much of a scholarship did you get?
A full ride.
Whoa! Good deal. Congratulations, that is absolutely wonderful. So with that, if there's anybody got anything they want to bring up? All right, with that, we're going to go ahead and adjourn this meeting, Council. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
All right, I have a motion and a second. All in favor? Thank you very much. Good evening.